Welcome to Hindu Analysis, August 25, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is Kolkata, best megacity, and Delhi, the worst one. So what this article is, the Center for Science and Environment recently released a report which is titled The Urban Commute and How It Contributes to the Pollution and Energy. So in that report, they stated that air pollution was a national crisis and road transport was the sector which is showing the highest increase in the emission of greenhouse gases. And also this report is based on the analysis of 14 cities in India. So they are taking 14 cities and they are doing some analysis, including 6 megacities like Kolkata, Chennai, Bangalore, Delhi, Mumbai, etc. And 8 metropolises like Bhopal, Vijayawada, Chandigarh, etc. So in this report, the analysis is done based on the urban commuting. So urban commuting in the sense, in the urban cities, how people are commuting on their day-to-day basis, and by means of that urban commuting, how far the energy is consumed by their vehicles and how much emission is done by the vehicles, or how much greenhouse gas emissions are done. So this is what they analyzed in this report. And so in that report, what they're actually stating is, the Kolkata, among the 6 megacities, Kolkata is the top performing megacity, and among the 8 metropolises, the Bhopal is the lowest overall emission, which means these two are the top performing in terms of the urban commuting efficiency. Okay, and similarly, if you see, Delhi and Hyderabad are the worst performing. They are worst polluters and they are not that much efficient in their energy usage. So if you see in this pick, it is the ranking of the cities in terms of their emissions and energy consumption. So among the 6 megacities, the Kolkata is tops, and then followed by Mumbai, Hyderabad, and Chennai and Delhi is the worst performing. And similarly, in the metropolises, the Bhopal is the first and Pune is the last. So in the same report, what they're actually stating is, before, during 1950s and all, it took nearly 60 years to get, for 105 million vehicles getting registered, it took nearly 60 years before, but now it just took 6 years, like 2009 to 15, to occur the same level of registration of the vehicles. So if you see here, this much amount of vehicle, 105 million plus 105 million, then how much emissions it could be done, which means the toxic emissions from these vehicles, like the particulate matter and the nitrogen oxides, are humongous in amount. And by means of this greenhouse gas emissions, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is also getting increased, which is also a major heat trapper. The carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is the heat trapper. So obviously it causes the global warming. So this report is based on overall energy consumption and emission in the cities, as well as per person energy consumption and emission. So by means of this calculation only, they are ranking the cities, and in that only the Kolkata tops. Okay, so what we have to learn from all these cities which tops in this ranking is, from Kolkata, despite the population growth and travel demand, there is a rising travel demand in the Kolkata as well as the population growth. But despite that, it is possible to contain the motorization. It encourages the people travel via bicycles or by means of efficiency. They are achieving this. So what kind of efficiency the Kolkata is following in the sense? So they actually have well established public transport culture. That is one thing. And they have compact city design, which means if you want to travel from one place to another place, it is compact space, so you can travel as faster as possible. And also the high street density, as well as restricted availability of lands for roads and parking. So these are the measures which is taken by the West Bengal government in order to achieve this much higher ranking. So similarly, in case of Mumbai, what if we observe, then the highest GDP is in Mumbai, but lower rate of motorization when compared to other cities, which means even though there is a highest GDP, the motorization is contained. So this indicates that not only the income level is the only reason for the dependence on automobiles. If your income is more, then obviously your dependence on automobiles is going to high. That is what our general presumption, but that is not true in case of Mumbai. So even though their income levels are high, people's dependence on automobiles is not that much high. So we have to learn from there also. And one more thing is, in Chennai, the Chennai is the first city to adopt a non-motorized transport policy in 2004, which means they encourage the commute by means of bicycles or carpooling, etc. So carpooling means sharing of the travel commute by means of car, etc. So this is one major move of Chennai authorities. So the second article is, ISRO telemedicine notes for soldiers in high altitude areas. So what the article is, in order to improve the emergency medical support to the soldiers who are getting deployed in the high altitude areas, especially Siachen glaciers, etc., the Integrated Defense Staff of the Defense Ministry and the ISRO signed a memorandum of understanding for what? To set up the telemedicine nodes in critical places for the Army soldiers, Navy soldiers and the Air Force soldiers. So in order to serve them, in order to serve the soldiers, they are actually planning to establish the telemedicine nodes in the critical places. Already we are having like 20 telemedicine nodes, but now they are actually want to further increase it to 50 telemedicine nodes. Okay, so what is the purpose of this telemedicine nodes in the sense? Because of the adverse terrain condition, you see here right in this pic. So because of this adverse terrain conditions as well as the extreme weather which is experienced by the soldiers, the emergency evacuation is becoming very impossible. So in order to remove that difficulty only, they are now trying to establish this nodes. And what is the purpose of this nodes is, the communication through the satellite enabled telemedicine node is going to be get established in order to make the services accessible and faster for the soldiers, as well as delivery of life-saving healthcare should be provided to those soldiers by means of these nodes, and the medical consultation for the soldiers who are getting experienced by means of these kinds of adverse weather as well as adverse environment. So the next article is Trouble in the Hills on Western Ghats Ecology. Okay, so what this article is, it questions whether political expediency trumped science, which means whether the political advantage bypasses the science. So the politicians or the political policies are making use of their advantageous position to overcome the scientific impacts which is caused by the humans. So what this article suggests is, the Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel, which is under the Environment Ministry. So this panel is to put recommendations for the preservation of fragile Western Peninsula region. So this panel usually gives the recommendations, and we are having two committees. One is the Gadgil committee, another one is the Kasturi Rangan committee. So these two committees are to review the recommendations which is put forward by this panel. So what the recent news is, the Madhav Gadgil, who is the head of this Gadgil committee, he stated that the recent havoc in Kerala is a consequence of short-sighted policy making. So the policy making is not long-sighted, it is short-sighted. So that is the reason why this recent havoc in Kerala took place. So we all know that Kerala is experiencing unprecedented floods as well as the human losses. So that is due to the short-sighted policy making. That is what he recently stated. So why he is pressurizing on Western Ghats means, we all know that Western Ghats is one of the biodiversity hotspot. So if you see in this pic, it has 140 mammal species, 250 reptile species and 510 bird species and 180 amphibian species. So these are all endemic to Western Ghats, as well as 25% of India's biodiversity is in the Western Ghats, as well as the new flora and fauna species are discovered every year in the Western Ghats. The great source of water and the fresh oxygen is also available in the Western Ghats. So these are all the reasons why the Western Ghats is one of the hottest of the biodiversity hotspot. So what they're actually telling here is, Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Goa and Maharashtra, these five states are responsible for the preservation of the Western Ghats, and we need to balance the human development pressure on the one hand and the protection of the Western Ghats on the other hand. So we have to maintain both the development as well as the preservation of the environment simultaneously. So that is what in this article they stated. We all know that the Western Ghats is the biodiversity hotspot. It is a globally acknowledged one. So we already saw two committees, right? One is the Gadgil committee as well as the Kasturi Rangan committee. So what they are actually pressurizing is, the Gadgil panel states the regulatory framework is necessary as of now, and Kasturi Rangan panel states the sustainable development for the Western Ghats is the need of the hour. So what they are stating in their recommendation is, the Gadgil panel says, under the Environment Protection Act, an apex Western Ghats Ecology Authority, a center authority should be made, and state level units should also be there. So an apex unit as well as a state level unit should be there in order to preserve this Western Ghats, and a zoning system is also needed in order to check the incompatible activities out of the ecologically sensitive zones. So if it is an ecologically sensitive zone, then there should be no activity which is incompatible with that zone should be taken place. It should be taken care by these units. So that is what put forward by the Gadgil panel. And the second one is the Kasturi Rangan panel. What he suggested is, the big hydroelectric dams which was built before during the power demand and the power deficiency situation. So we already built some big hydroelectric dams, right? We have to take care of that. We have to make it afresh instead of building new dams. This is one recommendation which is put forward by Kasturirangan panel. And also green energy led by the solar power should be given more priority, and the quarrying and the mining activities in the ecologically sensitive zones. If these kind of activities are going to be carried out in sensitive zones, then that should be necessary to assess the performance or the activities, whether it is compatible or non-compatible, what should be the precautionary steps we have to take in before starting these kind of activities. So these all should be assessed before the quarrying and mining. This is also put forward by the Kasturirangan panel. So this is the Western Ghats, okay. So we now saw the havoc which is happening in Kerala, right? So in the wake of the floods in Kerala, we have to wake up and we have to need to review the decisions which is putting forward by these two panels, and we have to take the decisions which is not affecting the environment, and the public consultation. We have to ask the people about all those things on the expert reports. So this is the way forward in order to preserve our biodiversity hotspot, which is the Western Ghats. So some more information about the Western Ghats. So it is on the west coast of India. So it extends up to 6 states: Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Okay, so these are the 6 states on which this Western Ghats is extending. So it is of range 1500 to 2600 kilometer, and its average elevation is nearly like 600 meter. So in this region, nearly 50 million people are surviving. Okay, so it is a source of water for the entire peninsular India. So it is a source of water for entire peninsular India, as well as it only influences the monsoon. So we know that the southwest monsoon and the northeast monsoon, so everything is affected by means of this presence. Okay, so it retains only 7% of the original forest cover. So this Western Ghats is the hottest of the biodiversity hotspots. So the fourth article is poll panel to brainstorm on key issues. So what the news here is, the Election Commission will be going to discuss on some of the key issues with 7 national political parties and 51 state political parties. So it will be going to discuss some key issues like how campaign silence be maintained during the last 48 hours before the elections, because it is an era of social media. So how we are going to maintain the silence during the last 48 hours of the election time, and how to limit the expenditure of the candidates as well as the political parties, and how to increase the participation of women in the election. So these are all the key issues which they are going to have, this Election Commission is going to have with the 7 national political parties and 51 state political parties. So the Election Commission is going to state some existing facts and going to ask the all these political parties certain questions in order to on these key issues. So the first one is, environment of neutrality and silence for the voter should be provided, right? So for a voter to exercise his universal adult franchise, an environment of neutrality and silence should be given. So you should not influence a voter before or during the last 48 hours of the election. So how to maintain that kind of silence to the voter? So this is what the Election Commission is asking. So another question is whether we have to include the print media, that like the newspapers as well as the social media, under the ambit of section 126(1)(b) of the ROPA. So whether we should include it or not, because already under section 126(1)(b) of ROPA, the television, cinematograph as well as the similar apparatus of the medias are prohibited in campaigning or advertising any political parties during the last 48 hours of the elections. So it is already prohibited, these three. Whether this print media or the social media is also to be included in this section or not, this is one question which is the Election Commission is going to put forward before all these political parties. So as per the present existing election law, it only limits the candidates' expenditure during the election time. It is not limiting the political parties' expenditure. So it led to the unaccounted money which is often spent over the people during the elections time. So in order to curb this unaccounted money spending by the political parties during the elections time, whether ceiling on party election expenditure in the Legislative Council elections should also be included or not? This is also one of the questions which the Election Commission is going to put forward in front of all the political parties, which means we have to, before we have candidates expenditure limitation, but now for the entire political party and also during the Legislative Council elections, state Legislative Council elections, right? So during that elections also, we have to put some limitations or ceiling on the party's election expenditure, whether we have to do it or not. This is one question. And the third one is alternative mode for domestic migrants as well as the absentee voters, whether we should provide it or not. If a person is not in his home state, if he is going to some other state, so we have to, as a government, has to provide the portability of voting right. Wherever he goes, he has to have his voting right. So that portability of voting right should be ensured to the domestic migrants as well as the absentee voters. So how we can provide that portability of voting rights? By means of postal or proxy voting or electronic voting. So by means of what we have to do in order to ensure the portability of the voting rights of the citizens. So this is also another question. And the last key issue which they are going to discuss is only 11.4% of women is in the Lok Sabha as of now, but the global average is nearly like 22.9%, but we are only half, right? So what measure should we have to take in order to enhance the representation of the women in the political parties? So this is also one of the key issue that they are going to discuss. So if we see during the first Lok Sabha in 1952, the first Lok Sabha, there is only 4.4% of the women representation. But in the 16th Lok Sabha, which is now 2014, we are having 11.9% of the women representation in the Lok Sabha. Though it looks like a massive increase in the number of women in the Lok Sabha, but it is not that much because we are having a global average of 22.9%. We are only half of that. So what kind of measures we should have to take forward in order to increase or enhance the representation of women? So if you see in terms of number, there were only 668 women out of 8,000 candidates. So only 29% of the women are from national as well as the state political parties. So only one good thing here is the number of women voters have increased from 55% to 65% from 2009 to 2014. So it is one good news. And another important thing is Sweden, Argentina, Nepal, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, all these countries have laws for reserving the seats for women in the legislature itself. So in the legislature, they are actually given the seats. Okay, so they are reserving the seats for the women. And similarly, in case of Argentina, Bangladesh, Bolivia, Mexico, etc., they are having laws which is providing quotas for women in candidate list itself. So for the candidate list itself, they are giving certain quotas for the women's. That means this much amount or this much percentage of women should be presented in that political party. So that is one of the thing which is taken by all other countries. So we should take all these things as an inspiration, and we also should take some measures in order to increase the representation of the women, in order to maintain the silence in the election during the last 48 hours of the election, and in order to limit the expenditure of the political parties, and we have to make the people aware of what is happening during the election time. So the last article is Forest Fund Rules is a blatant breach of assurances by the government. So this is what the former Union Environment Minister recently stated. So what the news here is, we should have to know about the Compensatory Afforestation Fund Act 2016. So this act was enacted, though it was enacted in 2016 itself, the rules are revised and it is made public only in this August only. So what this Compensatory Afforestation Fund contains, or what are the provisions or what are the power it has is, it is only stating what kind of projects are eligible in a place and how the composition of the national and the state authorities should be there in order to revise the provisions, and what are the decisions regarding the utilization of the funds they are getting under this CAF. So these are all the provisions under this Compensatory Afforestry Fund. So if you see in this pic, we are having National Compensatory Afforestation Fund and State Compensatory Afforestation Fund. So we are having national and state, okay? So these authorities will monitor the how the funds are getting utilized. So under this, what is this CAF meant for is, if you are going to cut some trees, then you have to plant some trees or you have to give that much equivalent of money to the government. So that is what the CAF aims at. So any user or any agency which diverts the forest land for non-forest purposes. So if you are going to destroy some forest for non-forest purposes, then you have to deposit certain prescribed amount of money to the government, and in that amount 90% of the amount will be go to the state fund and 10% of the fund will be go to the national fund. So this is what the existing provision, and this funds will be utilized for increasing the forest cover in some other areas and forest regeneration and wildlife protection in the biodiversity hotspots or in forest areas and related activities in order to protect the green car in our country. So these are all the funds which they are collecting under the CAF is aimed at. So what the news here is, the former Union Environment Minister objected this compensatory afforestation fund provision, stating that the rules which are governing the distribution of this 66,000 crore fund, so under the CAF they are now getting this much amount of fund as a compensatory afforestation. So how to distribute this fund between center and state and what are the purposes that this fund should be utilized for, so these are all the things are not that much efficient, and it is actually undermining the Forest Right Act as well as the PISA Act. So this is what he is recently stating. So why they are doing, in order to compensate for the loss of forest from industrial development, if you want to if some industries want to make industrial development in certain area, they are going to destroy the forest and they are going to develop the industries there. So they are only providing this much amount of fund. So it is actually undermining the Forest Rights Act as well as the Panchayat Extension to Schedule Areas Act. This is what the former Union Environment Minister stated. So now we are going to see what is this Forest Rights Act as well as the PISA Act. Okay. So he is telling actually this CAF is undermining these two acts, right? So we have to know the objective of these acts, then only we can come to a conclusion. So this FRA, which is the Forest Rights Act, was enacted in 2006. So under this act, its aim is to protect the rights of the tribal communities who are living there over a period of time, over a longer generations. So they are living there for a very long time. So in order to protect their rights over their lands or forest, this Forest Right Act was enacted in 2006. So this act has the potential to democratize the forest governance. So forest governance should be democratized under this act by recognizing community forest resource right over this much amount of land. So this 85.6 million acres of land is now under the control of 200 million forest dwellers in 170,000 villages. So this much amount of land is under their control. So this is actually a right which is provided to these traditional forest dwellers by the government, but by means of this CAF, which is a compensatory afforestation fund, they are just destroying the trees or they are just rehabilitating or replacing them to another place and they are just giving the compensation. So whether it undermines this Forest Right Act or not, so this is what one major question which rises. So another one is the PISA Act of 1996, which is the Panchayat Extension to Schedule Areas. So its main aim is to devolve the power to the PRI institutions at the grassroots level. So it is like empowering the tribal people or the indigenous people who are living there for over a longer period of time or for a longer generations. So we have to empower them. So that is the main purpose of this PISA Act, and it is also to enhance the living condition and ensuring the poverty alleviation of these tribal people who are dwelling in the forest. So we have to actually empower them, but by means of this CAF Act, we are now actually trying to again to compensate them with some kind of funds. So it is also again undermining this PISA Act. This is what the former Union Environment Minister stated. So how the former Environment Minister stated that the CAF would undermine this Forest Right Act as well as the PISA Act means, it actually reduced the authority of the Gram Sabhas itself. So the Gram Sabhas have no role or they have no say in their local compensatory afforestation project. And what he also telling is the Gram Sabhas have no role or no voice in determining how to utilize the funds or in giving ideas. They are just having the roles of consultants. So they are just treated as a consultant, not as a co-partner. So this is one thing. And another one is the power on how to utilize the fund or how to compensate or how to distribute the funds, everything is determined by the state level forest bureaucracy and not with the district level or not in the grassroots level. This is one of the major concerns which is he put forward. So, but the government is replying to him by saying that this CAF Act would not undermine the provisions of FRA as well as the PISA Act. How means? The state officer is actually there, But he is in the village committee only in order to ensure that the public money is being dispersed in a better way. That is, the money which is being given as the compensation, it is a public money. So how it is actually distributed, how it is utilized, it should be taken care only by the state officer. So only he is there. It is not undermining any power of the district level officers. It is one thing that the government is telling as a reply. And second one is, even though the state officer is there, the chairman of the village committee will be a villager only. So the member secretary is also there in the committee in order to looking at the financial disbursement of the CAF fund, and also a CAF authority is also be established inside this CAF act. That is what the government is telling as a reply to the former Union Environment Ministry. Thank you.